Welcome to MediaPath. I'm Fritz Coleman.
And I'm Louise Palanker.
Here at MediaPath, we suggest ways for you to occupy your time as we all sit around waiting to see if democracy survives. We introduce you to interesting content like books and streaming shows and movies and podcasts and any media. The centerpiece of our show, though, is always the amazing guests. And today we're bringing back a friend who produced and directed the single greatest documentary about session musicians and their role in 1960s rock and roll called The Wrecking Crew. We've talked about it a couple of times here. He's Denny Tedesco. And he's back with his latest film, which is the perfect follow-up to The Wrecking Crew, called The Immediate Family. In general, this is the story of five guys who took up the Wrecking Crew mantle and were pivotal players in the music of the 70s, 80s, even into the present. In it, Denny does another amazing job of documenting rock and roll. We're going to talk to Denny in just a few minutes. But Wheezy, what do you have for us?
So I watched a documentary on Prime called Filling in the Blanks. In vitro fertilization is coming under fire right now by lawmakers and far-right Christian factions, but it was even more controversial at its conception. Never pardon my puns. Before in vitro and what were originally called test tube babies, we had artificial insemination, which had been in practice with animals since the 18th century, but only began being widely utilized with humans in quiet and in private in the 1950s, meaning the kids were almost never told. Yes, infertility issues were personal, and it could be embarrassing and humiliating for the father when donor sperm was used to create his child. And so the tension of that shame and secrecy ripple throughout the emotional health of the family. Director John Blame says he always suspected that his parents harbored some sort of dark mystery. His father was distant and demanding, easily hurt and enraged and quick to judge. When the subject of DNA testing comes up at a family dinner, John's 92-year-old father forbids John to do it. John immediately goes out and buys a 23andMe kit, and his journey careens towards parts and relatives unknown. Today, when a child's genetic history is thought to be their right to know, it's hard to imagine there are generations of people who were never told their origin story. The thinking was that this was what was best for the child. In the early days of using insemination to create human families, it could certainly look like too much to unpack. Presto, here's your baby, let's all move on. But the living, breathing, growing child is a daily reminder to dad that his sperm was not in the recipe. Back in the 1950s, med students donated sperm in the interest of being helpful and furthering science. The kids they biologically fathered are now in their 50s and 60s, and many are only now finding out through DNA testing or through a parent finally revealing this important information as they reach the end of their lives. It is a revelation that can lead to a better understanding of their parents, their childhoods, and themselves. John Blame handles his journey with equal parts intensity and humor, and it's satisfying to watch him uncover with grace the truth that completes his story. Filling in the Blanks is on Prime.
Sounds great. I'm going to do a book this week.
Oh, okay.
It's Burn Book, A Tech Love Story by Kara Swisher. This is a combination of a memoir and a history of Silicon Valley. Kara Swisher was the first and best-known journalist to cover the tech world. She started at the Wall Street Journal and created what's called tech journalism. In the early 90s, nobody understood what tech industry was going to become. Then she went to the Washington Post and then ultimately the New York Times. She became famous for creating a tech conference called All Things Digital. This was a forum where over 30 years, she interviewed all of the tech titans. Steve Jobs, who was her favorite in the long run, Mark Zuckerberg, Sheryl Sandberg, Zuckerberg's second in command at Facebook, Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, all of the tech titans and all of the guys that didn't make it to the headlines. Most recently, Sam Altman, the founder of ChatGPT. Now, she is a tough cookie. She pulls no punches in pointing out the prima donnas, the boys with toys, the flagrant assholes. She lets us know the most self-centered white men in the world are running Silicon Valley. Mostly all of them are pathologically insecure. Some are in it to advance society. However, some are in it just for the money. I wanted to read this book because Swisher's a frequent talking head on the news programs, and I always enjoy her hip snarkiness. Mm-hmm. In the book, she remains optimistic about tech, but she doesn't think they're living up to their full potential. And her one big point that I definitely agree with is that Congress has not put up enough guardrails and sufficiently regulated tech to protect the general public from evil intent, especially with the onslaught of AI. It's an interesting book. I'm not very tech savvy, but there's a lot of humanity in this over and above the technology. It's Burn Book, A Tech Love Story by Kara Swisher. Pretty good read.
Does she teach you how to merge your calendars?
No.
No, that would have been helpful.
And I was looking for some instruction on how to, you know, play a podcast in the car, but it didn't work.
All right. That's in another book.
All right. If you saw The Wrecking Crew, we've talked about it in many aspects here. You watched the best music documentary ever produced. It was a look at this miraculous set of session musicians here in Los Angeles during the 60s. And they played on the majority of radio hits. The twist being, most listeners had no idea that these hugely popular bands were not playing on their own records. His new film, The Immediate Family, is a sort of a follow-up, highlighting the iconic players who could be heard and some of the greatest albums of all time from the 70s, 80s up to the present. They're Russ Kunkel, the drummer, Danny Cooch, Kortchmar, guitarist, Waddy Wachtel, fabulous rhythm guitarist, another previous guest on our show, Leland Sklar, preeminent bass player, fabulous human being, we'll find out when he gets here. We're going to have him drop by in a minute, who might still hold the record for the most sessions in the music industry.
Like, don't put me on the spot.
No, but he was very proud to tell us that. Yes. And then later on, Steve Postell, a great guitarist and producer. The movie is an historical document. We're so happy to have Denny with us in the studio. How are you, my friend?
Great. I think the last time we saw each other, well, we didn't see each other. It was COVID.
We did a Zoom.
Yeah, Zoom on COVID then when you guys started.
That's how you saw everyone. You didn't have to wear that much deodorant in those days.
I liked it.
Yep.
I mean, Wrecking Crew was unbelievable. It was the roots of Glenn Campbell.
Yeah.
I had a chance to open for him for one of his last live concerts in Palm Springs.
Yeah.
And I learned a lot about Alzheimer's on that. You know, his family ran his band. His wife was his manager at that point. And he did 2 hours of all those great Jimmy Webb hits.
Yeah.
And I mean, did a flawless performance for 2 hours.
It's amazing what that mind could do.
Yes. Yeah. And not a mistake. And then his wife said, but when he comes off stage, don't talk to him or expect him to answer because he's a little fuzzy. And I thought, isn't that fabulous? It's that muscle memory from years of working with a Wrecking Crew and having his own concerts. It was really unbelievable. But they could not have been a lovelier family.
No, it's funny because when I got to interview him, I think it was early 2000s. I took my crew to Phoenix, and it was like he forgot I was coming over. So at that point, I didn't know that nobody knew anything about, you know, any disease or anything at that time. And I remember asking him 4 or 5 questions, different questions, and he came back with the same answer of something. And I'm like, uh-oh, something's up.
He was really brave to do that documentary, which really...
Oh, my God. His documentary. It's a beautiful documentary.
It really is.
I don't mean to interrupt you guys, but Waddy's here.
Waddy's here.
Oh, geez.
I was going to surprise everybody. How are you, Waddy?
Surprise, it's Waddy.
No, let me intrude. Don't let me intrude.
No, stay there because we're gonna prosecute you in just a minute.
Well, actually, Waddy, his father... felt like Waddy was the next Glenn Campbell, right, Waddy?
Oh, that's what he wanted in his dreams. Yeah.
He finally gave it instead. Yeah, he's just like Glenn Campbell. Yeah.
I love your...
After telling me forever to get a real job and forget to get, you know, make that a hobby. Make that a hobby, you know.
I loved some of your snippets in the show, and I'm going to get to those. I love how brazen and brave you were in dealing with people producing records. No, that's not where you're not going to do a solo with a saxophone there. I fell off my chair when I heard that. But we'll get to you in a minute. Let me give your producers props first. I wanted to say is the main difference, Denny, between the Wrecking Crew and the Immediate Family is the Wrecking Crew were all studio musicians.
Yeah.
And the bands that went on the road with the various acts.
Always a separation.
It was a road band.
Yeah.
But the beautiful thing about the singer-songwriter era happening in the 70s and 80s, James Taylor, Carole King, they wanted to take the musicians who recorded on the albums on the road to duplicate these beautiful sounds. And so it opened up a whole different kind of business.
It's literally overnight. Right, Waddy? I mean, it just changed. I mean, it was like all of a sudden these guys... it was a different, the business changed. FM radio came in, LPs came in, and now everybody's given a little more money, a little more leeway for the artist. And so they had a lot more say.
But What also changed, like, technically? Were there more studios available so that you could take your time, so that you could nurture sounds?
No, I think, you know, there was always the same studios, but I'll let Waddy talk. But, you know, because you were on both sides. You saw the horrible times probably playing live, and then it got better.
Well, I think, you know, a lot of the thing that happened studio-wise and between the Wrecking Crew and our generation of guys is that albums became the thing rather than singles.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, there was more time thought of to give to a record because every song mattered. You know,
yeah.
Back then, you know, the single was what mattered. And I mean, you know, but you know, Mamas and Papas records and a lot of the records that Lou did with and Brian,
right?
And those were incredible. But
yeah.
Prior to them, you know, the single was the one, and then just fill up the record with other songs. They didn't get that.
And they were covered.
Care or money or production.
Mm.
They were
it's a whole different thing.
Horrible
But for
songs.
Us, because it was the singer-songwriters, they were coming in with you know, a whole stack of songs they wanted to record. And so more time was being allotted that way.
And were we in the States influenced by the ability that the Beatles had to write their own songs and to take time in the studio in their creation? Was that something that the singer-songwriter generation wanted to emulate, that kind of creativity?
Well, but the thing is, Beatles never took a long time in the studio until later.
Oh, okay.
I mean, they were like pumping out 3 albums a year, and they would go in the studio and would cut like 3 songs a day, and they were incredibly prolific and driven hard, but they were able to do it. But yeah, that started to become the norm. You know, like the Eagles, all of a sudden the Eagles were setting the standard for you could take your time in the studio. You know, you could take your time. So when I started with, like when I met Jackson and when I was working with Warren, we weren't being as rushed as you were when I started doing sessions. It was hurry up, let's get this done. You got to do, you know, we got 6 songs to cut here. Where, you know, you'd go in and you'd want to get a song down, really get it down the right way.
Waddy, would you like to finish that thought and then introduce our next guest star, which would be young Leland?
Be my honor, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen.
I hope you sit in one of those cool cars.
My brother from another mother and my brother from another universe, dear, dear friend, Leland Sklar.
Yay!
There it is.
And now I said, what are you doing here?
I have no idea.
Great to have you back, Lee. How are you?
It's good to be here. How are you?
Doing great. I made a comment earlier before you arrived that you hold the record for the greatest number of sessions. Do you still, I don't know, it was either 2,000 or 10,000, but you hold the record, for, I think.
Well, there's no record. I'm just happy to be a working musician. That's really what it's all about.
You are so zen. You're too zen for your own good.
Well, I'm getting an antibiotic shot for it. And, it's working so far. They started with suppositories and they just, I got strung out. So I've changed my approach.
Let me talk to all you guys about this. This movie starts in the perfect way, Denny, which is this animated family tree that evolves.
Yeah.
And each one of those leaves is another song that this group of people played on. Oh my God, it was fun. It's like a giant ficus tree evolving on this. That was really,
thank you.
It shows you the power of this group of guys.
Now that was fun to do because it was like, I used to do the, I used to produce Time Life projects. Mm-hmm. And you know, remember you watch those things and you hear the song and you wonder, what's that song? And then it comes up with a different color.
Yeah.
It's like, so that's why I put the leaves and the flowers on it. But it was fun. These guys, I mean, had so many artists to choose from.
Oh, absolutely. And a highlight of your film is where you have each musician in the studio solo with headphones playing their part, which we first hear in isolation, and then you slowly pull up the full sound of the record. And you may have been inspired by Leland's YouTube channel, which really flourished over COVID, where he plays along with his more legendary tracks.
Does Leland want to admit to that?
I think we're talking points.
No, I actually did it in the first film. I did it in the first film because everybody kept saying, oh, you got to, you know, have more playing. So I finally put Hal in the studio, put headphones on, and I realized, wait a minute, that's how I would see Hal play in the studio. I want to know what he's hearing. So it was an easy thing to do, what I did with him and Joe Osborne. and a couple
others.
It was
fun to try to guess what the song was going to turn into.
Well, I always wonder if people guess. You know, and you never try to do it where it's obvious. It's like, I remember when I did with Chuck Berghofer with Nancy Sinatra in the Boots, I thought, you can't do the slide because they know instantly what that is. You got to let them hear something else and then bring it in.
It kind of lets people know how much is in these tracks, that you have to listen to them differently, you know, once you know there's a lot of good stuff buried in there.
I don't know if you guys ever felt what I was doing. Did you have an idea what I was doing? Or did you just go with it?
No, I think we...
You told us what you were going to do.
Yeah, but did you believe me?
We saw it in the Wrecking Crew movie.
I don't know if you actually hear me, though. It's a difference.
We were actually paying attention to you, even though it didn't feel like it.
Yeah.
One afternoon, we were paying attention.
There was so much respect in their disrespect. You know?
That's it. If there's no disrespect, then I haven't done well.
So I love the history, and I love all the octopus-like connections to this film. And one of the focal points is Peter Asher. Peter Asher of Peter and Gordon. Talk about the impact he had in drawing you guys together and sort of getting you on your way.
I'll start it, because the one thing I said to Peter in my interview with him, I said something about these guys being legends. And he looked at me like I was high. He goes, they weren't legends when I was working with them. They were just friends of friends. They were, you know... Danny was friends with James Taylor and da-da-da, and they found Leland, and then Waddy comes in a little later. But you guys, you had the first relationships with Peter. You could talk about it.
Well, I mean, it was really kind of remarkable. I was in a band in the late 60s in L.A. called Wolfgang, and our drummer had a friend named John Fishbeck who owned Crystal Recording Studios, and he had done all the early Stevie Wonder records there. And he, at one of our rehearsals, he brought a friend of his to the rehearsal, and who had just gotten back from England, and it was James. And they had just finished cutting Sweet Baby James. And Peter was managing and producing James at that time. And they had booked the gig at the Troubadour to kind of launch James's career. And they had Cooch, because they were old friends, on guitar, and they had found Russ Kunkel through John Stewart. And Carol King came in because of her relationship. She and Danny were friends. And Carol was only the piano player in the band. No, there was no acknowledgement of her as a songwriter or as an artist or anything. She was the piano player. And James remembered me from this rehearsal, and Peter tracked me down, and they brought me in to do one gig, which really turned out to be the rest of my life.
Wow.
And the one thing that was remarkable with Peter, I mean, first off, I knew of Peter because I was such a fan of everything that came over in the English invasion. And I was a big fan of Peter and Gordon. So it was kind of, he was one of my first fanboy moments where I was kind of going, wow, that's really Peter from Peter and Gordon kind of thing. And I'd only been in a studio really once before I met those guys, and that was doing a day of demos with Wolfgang. I had no studio chops whatsoever. And then all of a sudden we end up with James, and the next thing you know, he's on the cover of Time magazine and he's the talk of the town, and my phone starts ringing off the hook. Wow. And I was really having to learn my craft at the job. I had musical abilities, but I had no studio chops at all. So, but the thing that really was a game changer for all of us, and it is talked about in the movie, was Peter was one of the very first people to put musicians' credits on an album.
Yeah, I was going to get into that, and that changed everybody's life, right? You guys became stars on your own right. You had that great story of working with James Taylor, and people in the front row have, yay, we're Lee Sklar fans in the front line.
Yeah.
There's several different factors, too, because it was also that you were on Letterman with these guys. You were on the VHS tapes that we bought of the whole concert.
Yeah.
So people didn't only know your names, they knew your faces.
What there is of it.
and that I'm sure, I loved hearing some of the other commenters in the film say they were always fans of you. When they found out who they were, they sort of bought the record because you guys were on it.
Phil Collins says that.
That's what I was trying to think of, Phil Collins. And also, that probably got you work.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the thing that was interesting for everybody is everybody had an image and a persona about them. And unlike a lot of other people, like Waddy and I are still pretty true to how we've looked since day one. Maybe things have, lightened up or something like that. But I look at gigs that we did back in the 70s, and I would look at that station, there's Waddy. And then I go to a gig now and I see him, I go, there's Waddy. Yep. It's not like somebody who's gone through all kinds of different image changes and all that. We've been pretty true to who we are. So there's been a consistency throughout our careers from that aspect, beyond the playing side of it, which has been so solid and consistent. It's really kind of this visual aspect of it.
Yeah, you bring up a great point. You talk about the playing side of it, too. And I don't know if Cooch is the one that brought this up, but I thought it's so true. You guys really came into your own. When you were hired to do gigs, it wasn't like the typical session thing where you got in there and did whatever the producer wanted you to do. They hired you to be Lee. They hired you to be Waddy. They wanted to hear your sound on the record.
Yeah, that's what it became. It became, forget the chart. Let's hear what you want to bring to the song. And it was great. It was, these guys were working a little steadier than I was. I was the last one to meet the rest of my family here. But I was in relation to Peter found me when I was playing with Danny, Russ, and Lee, and we were playing on Carol's tour on her follow-up record to the Tech. He was Thoroughbred. Which an album that didn't go very far, but it put us all together. And we toured with Carol. And when we played UCLA, Peter Asher was at that show. And the next thing I know, a couple nights later, I get a phone call from Peter. And we'd never met. He was one of the producers I still hadn't worked for in town. And he said, I'll take you to lunch. I want to talk to you about working for Linda. So that was my introduction through playing with James. Playing with Carol and Lee and Danny and Russ, I wound up with Peter and we sat at lunch. He wanted me to go tour with her. And I told him, I told him what Carol paid us. He goes, well, I can't pay you that. I said, well, then forget it. Thanks for lunch. but we came to an agreement. And then he says, hey, I'm going over to the rehearsal. You want to see your friends? So I went to James's rehearsal, walked in, and there was the rest of my boys playing with James, who I'd never met at that point. And then shortly after that, I started working on records for James, too. And then we were on the road. We've been on the road together since that moment, really.
Well, yeah. Since you guys are brothers and you are family, did you learn anything new about each other through the making of this film?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that was the thing that blew my mind was the very first screening of it. Because our time together has always been working. And, we've never really, we don't get together and go out to lunch and all that, or at least I don't. I'm really not very sociable when I'm not working. I really kind of a homebody. And all of a sudden, to have each guy talking about their history, I knew that Cooch knew James as youngsters on Martha's Vineyard. But just kind of talking about, them walking around and him hearing James singing a Ray Charles song.
You can sing.
Yeah. I mean, there were nothing earth-shattering was revealed, but there were little nuggets in it that really made me, like when you talk about, it's a really poignant and touching thing when you talk about your mom's passing and that you've gone through life, you and your brother and your dad and all this stuff. And your dad was such a part of our whole scene too. Every time we got back there and Harry was around, it was such a treat.
I think you bring up a good point. The inspiring thing in this movie for me was you guys have been in the business for 50 years and every one of you just appreciates what you have and appreciate what you had back then and the experience you had. There's no bitterness. It's like it's all a miracle that we all survived and did well. And I was smiling about that at the end of the film.
It's a miracle for sure that we're all still here, and it's because of music that we're all still here and so dedicated to one another and to music still. And I don't know if you call that a blessing or what, but it depends what you believe in, I guess. But it's a miracle for sure that we're still and vibrant and important enough for people to want to hire us still. Like we always say, if that phone ain't ringing, we're in trouble. And it's ringing, so thank goodness.
I also think one of the unique things about this band is, you know, I hear story after story about all these bands that have been on the road and they can't stand each other. They travel separately. They only come together to be on stage and that's it. But we're all friends. I mean, there's never been arguments. There's the only time anything would ever arise is when we're working on material. And those are really just discussions about, you know, arrangements and who's going to do what and all that. And there isn't even that much of that because it's so organic at this point with everybody. But it's not one of these things where you go, oh, I've got to see that guy again. Oh, Christ. You know, I mean, because so many of them, it's just business. Or the other aspect of this to me that's wonderful is there's other groups of musicians that are of our ilk and our era. But what they're doing is they're just doing like the songs they had in the 80s kind of thing. And they're trying to get back into spandex after working 10 years at Home Depot. But the fact that we're still creating new music and looking forward, and it's not like a nostalgia group. It's nostalgic from the standpoint of pulling out some of these old songs that people have, you know us from. But there's also a ton of new material, too, that people are responding to. So this is still an organic growing entity. It's not a tribute band.
Right.
No.
And I just was wanting to ask Denny, if I may, what you learned, because the wrecking crew took you so long to finish, and that was you just,
that's 19 years.
You being the most persistent, consistent guy, like, let's get to the finish line. And that's so heroic. And thank you for that film, because so many of us just adore it.
Thank you.
But what did you learn from making the wrecking crew that helped inform you in terms of making then Immediate Family?
Watching the wrecking crew with audiences, I realized how important it was an accident. When you watch a film the first time with audiences, things change. You go, wow, I didn't think that was funny in the edit. And the audiences are laughing or they're crying. And watching the audiences with the music's one thing. You got them 50%, you got it nailed by just the music. But if you don't have story and that they can relate to, in the Wrecking Crew, people were relating to the fact that I was a son of the father that passed away, or the relationship of where these guys are in their career. Is it at the beginning, the middle, the end? And you have to have something to relate to these guys. So going into this, I already knew that in a sense. I understand it from a son's point of view of a musician. I'm not a musician. So I think that might have given me a head, you know, a leg up in a sense. And, you know, asking these guys personal questions, you know, and knowing, it's more than music. It's not a music doc. Yes, it's a music doc, but I think it's more than that.
Oh, yeah. It's so much more. When you get to that scene where Carole King and James Taylor are on the road, Troubadour tour.
Yeah.
And these guys, you know, Lee, can look into the eyes of the audience and see what his body of work has meant to folks.
Yeah.
It's very, you well up, you watching that, you really do.
It was really cathartic doing that tour, just seeing the impact. And that's in the movie, I think that's Cooch's moment where he talks about, you know, looking out and seeing mothers and daughters and beyond people. But the most remarkable thing is how often people come up to you and just go, that you're the soundtrack of my life,
Absolutely.
And all that music meant births and deaths and divorces and marriages and so many things to so many people. And you just so appreciate the fact that you've been able to touch people. And I always look at them and I go, it's the soundtrack of my life too. Even if I was involved in it, it still is the soundtrack of my life. And I can sit and listen to all that music. I'm so objectively, I just listen to it as an entirety. I don't sit there and go, oh, listen to my bass part, that sucks, or I could have done better here or something. I never even think that way. I just really still enjoy the music as a entity unto itself.
Yeah, and we all have our, whatever our passion is or whatever is most meaningful to us. The first thing I ever did with the Cowsills was the Billy Benefit concert, which was like, I don't know what year it was, like 2003. I love the Cowsills. So I'm going to get involved. I'm telling my sisters, da-da-da-da-da. And my older sister's like, yeah, yeah. And then she goes, all of a sudden she goes, wait, Waddy's going to be there? So they both signed up to volunteer because one of my sisters loved the Cow Seals with me and the other one loved Waddy, you know, and Stevie Nicks and James Taylor and all and everything. And that was what she was excited about. So
Waddy, did you see the Cow Seals movie?
I did see it, yeah. And I got to tell you, Louise, I really wasn't ready for when Billy spoke about how he had that fight with Bud about over me.
Yeah.
And that the whole thing revolved around Billy and my relationship. I was blown away. I was moved to tears quite a while. It took me a while to be able to finish the movie.
I'm really sorry.
Wasn't ready for that. It was killing me, Louise. Thank you.
Sorry, Waddy, but it was going to happen. You know it was. You knew Billy, right? And you knew Bud, and it was going to happen.
Yeah. No, I know that. But, I mean, for it to be about me being the straw that broke the camel's back, you know, is it don't talk about Waddy like that, man.
I'll just help. If you haven't seen the film, I'll just help you understand what Waddy's referring to is that Billy Cowsill was the older Cowsill brother. And the kids refer to him as the Brian Wilson of our group. And Billy and Bud Cowsill was a very domineering father. And once Billy got old enough to stand up to Bud, Bud fired him from the band. And since half of the band was still underage, there was nothing anybody could do about it. But the moment that they almost came to blows was when Bud said something derogatory about Waddy. And Billy, who's close to the end of his life when he gives the interview that's in our film, says, Waddy is my North Star. And once you say something about him, I'm going to come at you. And so I was worried about you, Waddy, because you had been so sweet to come and be in the film. And I knew you were going to see that moment from Billy and that was going to break your heart. So I'm sorry.
It really No. It was great. It needed breaking. It was great to know that. You know, as a matter of fact, I want you to know, my first session as a hired guitar player, because I did some sessions for the Cow Seals. I produced some things they did, played on some stuff for them, but it was for Billy's, when Billy broke away and his first his solo album. That was the first hired gun session I did. It was Keltner was there. Sneaky Pete was playing pedal steel. I can't remember who was playing bass, but it was Billy.
Nobody remembers the boring teacher.
The bass, who cares, you know?
Yeah, it gives a shit.
But Waddy, if you would, while we're on this, talk a little bit about Billy and his talent, because a lot of it was unseen by a lot of the world because of what...
Well, he was an incredible singer, first of all. And he was he and I would sit up at night just listening to Beach Boys records and listening to Beatle records. And if you had ever seen the Cow Seals when I met them, when they were kids, and Barry and John were like, they shouldn't even have been up that late in a club. They sounded so much like Beatles. When they did a Beatles song, it was insane. Because Billy knew every inflection, and he taught the boys exactly what to do. And he was just purely musical and a complete devoted singer and an excellent, excellent singer with a beautiful voice. And we communicated on so many levels.
You have such a beautiful soul and a great heart, but you also are a no bullshit person. I want you to tell the story about Steve Perry's song.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Sherry.
His song, Oh Sherry, I got called by our dear, dear friend, Nico Bolas, who works with us still, a great producer. He was engineering and co-producing Steve's record. And he called me, said, there's a song they need me to play rhythm on. And I said, okay, great. So I sent my stuff out and I went out to Record One and they played me this song, Oh Sherry. And it's like, we have the luxury of hearing these amazing songs before anyone else hears them. And that is really, and then also I want to add one other thing. We also have the luxury of hearing them in these rooms that you can't hear music like that anywhere else.
Yeah.
The speakers and these rooms that we listen to music on, it's unbelievably great. It's so, when it's loud, it's fantastic and it's clear as a bell. So anyway, I go there. There's this great track, this great song, Larry London, killing drum track. Bobby Glob playing bass, I think. And it's great. And it needed my rock and roll eighth notes on it. It needed that driving thing. Mm-hmm. So I did it. And Steve said, oh, that's great. That's great. And he left the room. And so there's just Nico and I. And Steve goes, okay, well, thanks, man. That's it. Yeah, that's great. And Nico, I looked at Nico. I said, what does he mean, that's it? What? He goes, that's, you know, that's what he wanted. That's all he needed. But what are you talking about? I said, what about the solo part? He goes, no, he's going to put a sax there. I went, a sax? I could hear it in my head.
Yeah.
I knew what I wanted to play there. I could hear it. I mean, it was, that song just dictated what needed to be there to me. And I just said, are you kidding me? A sax? There's going to be a sax on this. Well, give me a track. I'll show you this is what should be there. And I played the solo there. There's a few notes at the very end of it where Steve came in, and the ending wasn't quite finished. And Steve came in, but he heard the thing. He just went, whoa, what's that? And I said, that's your solo, man. He goes, that's fantastic. And then we just kind of finessed the last couple notes of it together.
It's a great story.
Well, yeah.
And the ending of it. And it was a great moment. But it was, that's, I mean, when you get to hear music the way we hear it, and these songs, I mean, some of the songs that we've got to work on, and you hear it before it comes out, and you know, like Betty Davis Eyes, for example, is a live performance. So that record is everything that happened when we performed it. I mean, Nico's rough mix is the mix of the record. They could never get a better mix on it.
Wow.
So when we finished that song, I don't know if this is in the movie or not, I can't remember, but Val Garay produced it, and we did the track. I just happened to be there. I wasn't even supposed to be on it, really. I just happened to stop by the studio, and our friend Josh Leo wasn't able to be there. So they asked me if I'd play on it. I said, okay, sure. And we played the track. But everything, her vocal, every instrument, every percussion sound, every sound that you hear on it went down live. So when we started to walk into the booth, I grabbed Val and I went, listen, I just want you to know, this is a smash. What just happened here is going to be a gigantic smash, man. I'll bet you anything this is going to be a huge record. And then we all went in the booth and heard back the record. You know, nothing else was added to it. That was it.
Unlike the Wrecking Crew, who was all studio and no concert work, you guys learning these tracks so with such precision in the studio meant that when you went out on the road, you hit the ground running, and these things were perfect from day one, right? It wasn't like you had to get the band up to speed when it's time to hit the stage.
Well, again, that was Peter's concept. It was Peter that wanted the band that played the record to be out there on the road with the artists, so it sounded exactly the same, yeah.
So did you have a lot of artists just waiting for you to return before they would cut their next record?
Fortunately, we had good timing on that level, I'd say, wouldn't you say, Lee? I mean, we had,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
A lot of people would say, if you leave town, you're going to lose your slot, you know, you'll lose that chair. But we were able to go on the road and come back and get back to work. It was amazing. It was amazing, really.
Yeah, one of the things to me was, as much fun as it is, it's a profession. And you really needed to treat it professionally. And when I knew there was a tour coming up, there were people that I had, you know, said I would work with on a regular basis. And I would always call them weeks in advance saying, hey, I'm leaving town at such and such time, and I'll be back at such and such time. And they so appreciated the fact that they were in the loop.
Yeah.
That they would either maybe move a date up so they could get it before you left town, or they would hold off till you got back. And there were times I would come off the road and go from LAX to a studio rather than going home.
Wow.
Because, you know, there was a date butted right up.
Yeah, that's right.
It was treating everything with respect and professionalism so that, you know, people really knew that we cared about what we did. This wasn't just a job. This wasn't 9 to 5. And it really, you know, it's been that way forever. I mean, we still, every time anything's coming up, we talk schedules and stuff and work things out or find alternative ways of doing it. But everybody still is doing what they did then. I mean, the fortunate thing is to be, after now 54 years solid of doing this, that we're still, you know, getting calls. And I just got a call from Nick Collins and Trevor Lukather to see if I'd be in town next week. The track we're doing with Steve Perry in a thing.
Oh, wow. Really? Oh, neat.
Yeah, and I said, I can't. I'm on the road and I don't get home until the 28th, but I said maybe next time and stuff. But could work with them because I worked with, I mean, Trevor is Steve Lukather's son and Nick Bill Collins' son. So, you know, be around those guys and be in other generational situations. It's really a trip. I love it.
Lee, you have the best story I've ever heard about the division of art and commerce. When you're talking about when stuff goes bad and you run out of money, you're standing on a street corner and the guy next to you is a banker who's out of work. Tell that story. I just love that.
Well, I meant it more as like a record executive rather than a banker. But it's one of those things where a lot of times, you know, people kind of look at us as like this weird rung on the ladder. We're not like the upper echelon of it. But I just said, you know, look, we'll stand on a corner and you be a record executive and I'll play bass and we'll see who gets paid. At the end of the day, I mean, it's not demeaning them, but there's a certain thing that goes on where players, you know, we can, you know, it's like working with somebody like James Taylor. James Taylor can walk out on stage with an acoustic guitar and sell his music to an arena of people. So we're like frosting on the cake. We take these things to another level. And one of the reasons the artists would hire us is because they love the idea of making the music sound so much more complete and orchestrated and all the things that come with it. But at the end of the day, we just all have so much fun playing. When we're rehearsing and stuff, it is a joyous atmosphere. There's nothing really stressful. I mean, there's moments of it, but for the most part, it is really an absolutely joyous thing. And I still pinch myself every day that I still get to do what I get to do.
Well, you know? Your film is packed with talent. You've got Carole King, Linda Ronstadt, Jackson Browne, Phil Collins, Neil Young over Zoom. He looks like he's teaching like a Zoom.
No, you know, can I say
junior college class?
Someone described him, you'll appreciate this, as a crazy weatherman.
He did with the suspenders and everything.
Oh my God.
Then he leans into the camera.
Of all people to tell that to, Fritz.
Okay, oh no, that's
so,
okay.
Well, so give us some backstory. You have Stevie Nicks, James Taylor. There's so many people in the film, but like, and you, sometimes you just have to work with people to get them in your film, right? So,
that's it. And that was all COVID. I mean, we did everything up to that point when COVID hit. We had got the guys in the studio doing that, but I didn't have the guys yet. And I had Linda, Carole, James, Jackson, Phil, and it was amazing. And then all of a sudden COVID hit. It was like, what are we going to do? Because I didn't have these guys. Now we have to take it easy. We slowly went back out, just me, sound man, and a camera, got them. Well, Neil Young, you know, he said he'd do it, but he's not going to do it in person.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay, let's do, you know, whatever. It's, again, it goes back to what's the message?
Mm-hmm.
It's not always the look. So if Neil did a audio interview and he had the message, that's just as good. You know, we get so used to hung up. And I learned that on the first documentary because I wasted time shooting film when I could have been interviewing my father with a cassette player. And I didn't want to, you know, so it was like, I'll take whatever. And Stevie was another one that we did Zoom. But that was it. Stevie, her, and
didn't Henley hold off for quite a while?
Well, Henley, yeah, but... Yeah, but no, I went in person.
He just
to
held
do
off because he was uncomfortable still early
on. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Henley, I did in person in Dallas, and that was fun. You know, and it's surprising. And Crosby. Right?
Yeah.
Kush worked with Henley and even wrote that song, All She Wants to Do Is Dance, which was one of my favorite ones. And until I saw this movie, I didn't know he was the writer of that song.
And the thing about Henley is everybody knows, well, not everybody knows, but Henley and Danny, very opinionated gentlemen.
I know, I can't.
And
believe.
You guys be quiet back there. And very strong headed. And as my grandmother would have said, testadure, which is a stubborn head. But I think even though they had their issues with each other, the fact that they both could talk about each other and talk about the love of that they had with each other, or love of the music.
Mm-hmm.
And for Don Henley to do that, he didn't need to do that interview. That says a lot about Don Henley coming, you know, for me to go there and say, yeah, I'll talk about it.
Well, because he loves him.
Yeah.
So it's really love is at the yeah, core of everything.
Absolutely.
Right.
So why
it was so sweet too, having Crosby.
Yeah.
Oh,
there
we go. Now right. that he passed, you
yeah.
know,
it's, months later
when
he
talks about going, when he talked about going to see Things to Come, Russell band, he goes, yeah. band, tuck. Russell was fantastic.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. Another yeah. opinionated guy, right?
And it's funny because yeah. Crosby has all you guys, even including Steve Postell. But Waddy, you want to tell about how you met him?
I met him when I first moved to LA, and like the second night in Los Angeles, we went to a restaurant. Can't remember the name of it. It was right next to the Old World up on Sunset Boulevard.
Okay.
And it was sitting outdoors, and a couple of tables away, David Crosby sitting at a table, and I'm fresh out of New York City. I'm 20 years old, and I'm just going, I can't even believe this, with the fucking David Crosby sitting right there. What am I supposed to do now? Do I make a fool of myself and go introduce myself?
Yes.
Or do I let this moment pass by? And I just grabbed my shirt and went, get up. And I walked over. I said, excuse me, Mr. Crosby. My name is Waddy Wachtel, and just got here from New York, and I have a band. My manager, Louise, you'll like this. I said, our manager is Bud Cowsill, the father of Cowsills, and Crosby went, oh.
Oh, good.
And I went, I know. But we're not the Cowsills. We have a band. I'd love you to come. We'd love you to come hear our band. Would you think you might want to do that? He went, okay.
Really?
Wow.
He said, yeah, okay. And he came by, and after hearing the band, and he spent with my Judy, who is the girl of the band, who was great. She just passed away, actually, but she was the lyric writer. She and I wrote the songs. She was wonderful. She made dinner. He had a great dinner. And a couple nights later, David called me to say, just like what you said about Russ, you know, about the band sucks. He says, Waddy, you know you're the only one in that band, right? And I went, oh, please, don't tell me this. He goes, you know, right? I said, well, I know I can play. He goes, yeah, you can play, and these guys can't. You know, you belong here.
Oh, my gosh.
I said, well. And then he also said, he called me and said, this is great. He goes, listen, I want to ask some, what would you think if I was to put a band together, which Stephen Stills and Graham Nash? I went, what do I think?
He said that to you?
Dave Crosby. Yeah. I said, I don't have to think about that, David. I said, that's the biggest act in the world. For as long as you want it to be. Are you kidding me?
Wow.
Me and you guys? It was
what
fantastic.
A memory. Those
moments are so great because I was working in the studio with Henley, and he was playing drums on a project. I think it was a guy named Ron Roberts. And Henley, on one of the breaks, comes over and he goes, do you think Eagles is a stupid name for a band? I thought Beatles. Stupid name for a band.
How are that's we spelling great. Eagles?
You know, see, that's the whole thing. And for me, my Crosby moment was I went to Valley State College, Cal State Northridge.
Yeah.
And I went to Devonshire Downs to see Jimi Hendrix play. And I'm standing there, and I'm looked next to me, and I'm standing next to David Crosby in 1968 watching
He's
Jimi
everywhere.
Hendrix.
Yes. Yeah. He's selling.
He's selling.
No idea.
Waddy, you have, as does Lee, but I love the one in the movie talking about your connection with old rock and roll through the Everly Brothers and newer rock and roll through Warren Zevon, and you all make this triangle. Discuss how that all happened.
Well, I was called, there was a friend of mine who was a bass player, called me about doing some session work, and I went over to his house. He says, come on over, I want to talk to you about something. So I went over there, and he's telling me about the schedule, I want to do these sessions and this and that. And he goes, oh, by the way, the Everly Brothers are looking for a guitar player. And I went, wait a minute, you gotta be kidding. I said, that's my gig, man. I know every song, I know every vocal, I know both. I know the lead part, I know the harmony part, I know every guitar part. How do I get this? That's my job, come on. So he says, all right, well, I'll give you this phone number. He writes down this name, Sandy Zevon. He says, call this guy. He's like the band leader. And and he'll set up an audition. So I did that, called Sandy's Yvonne, and I got to SIR, and I'm thinking, who's Sandy's Yvonne around here? I'm looking around, and the bass player had been with him for a while. I met him, Bob Kinnegy, his name was, and then the drummer came in. He was auditioning also. And I'm asking him, are you Sandy? Are you Sandy? No, no. And all of a sudden, in walks this guy with this seersucker jacket on, Dora hat, shades, and I went, this guy must be with the record company or something. This guy's got a jive ass. Got to be with the record company. He goes, hey, I'm Sandy Zivon. I went, yours? Oh, hi. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. And so I auditioned and I got the job. And Warren and I, we were like kind of oil and water right away. You know, just from my visual look at him, I went, oh, what's this? And we kind of, we always agreed about the Rolling Stones, and we always agreed about Merle Haggard, and anything else there was up for discussion.
Okay.
How incredibly lucky we were to be playing for Donald and Phil, because that was an amazing reality.
Yeah.
You co-wrote, I might have misinterpreted this, did you co-write Werewolves of London, or you were part of the creation of that song?
Yes. It's true.
Man,
I did.
I think he was a great unsung hero of rock and roll.
Oh, yeah. It's iconic.
That song, it was so funny because when we did the Excitable Boy record, Warren and I were so proud of a couple of other songs on the record that when the record company, in being so correct, say, that's the single, Werewolves of London, Warren and I both went, are you kidding? What? That's the one you want to go with? And they were so right.
Wow.
And we were both so incredibly wrong. It was amazing that, you know, how blind we were to what that song meant to people, what it would mean to people.
You guys all admitted it. Lenny Warnker in your Warner, is that how you pronounce it?
Yeah, Lenny.
He admitted, you never know what the hit's going to be. He said, you record all these songs, the musicians don't know, we don't know. It's always often a surprise.
Is it the song that stays in your mind? How do you,
I knew Betty Davis Eyes was a smash. Yeah. But
right. So interesting.
Werewolves of London, the last thing on my mind would ever, anyone ever give that the time of day, even with, you never know. You know, you might know here or there.
But if you find yourself humming it while you're making coffee, or maybe that's what it is. I don't know. It's like, what is going to stick with folks?
It's hard to know that one.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's hard. Yeah.
Sometimes I wake up singing songs I hate and I can't get it out of my head.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Even if you hate it, so you have to play another song to erase it.
I felt that way when we did It's Raining Men.
That is a good track.
I love that song.
Yeah.
Paul Schaefer produced that. Yeah.
Paul Schaefer and Paul Jabara wrote it. And Paul Jabara was supposed to be the artist on it. And it didn't work out. So they got two tons of fun and changed them into the Weather Girls.
Hey, Lee, you have a broad musical background in that you played with Billy Cobham, and you have some jazz roots. Were you able to do jazz sessions at the same time you were doing all this great rock and roll stuff?
Yeah. That for me is the excitement of being a studio musician. So I could be, you know, do James Taylor one day and then be with Billy Cobham the next, and then with Stephen Curtis Chapman doing a contemporary Christian stuff, for Andy Griffith doing, you know, gospel with him, and all kinds of stuff, you know, and working with, you know, with Merle and Willie and those people, did a lot of country records and stuff. So for me, it's the eclectic nature of what I get to do that really keeps my interest fresh. Got it.
Yeah.
Hey, Denny,
yep.
We talked about this with the Wrecking Crew, and you mentioned it earlier. It took you 19 years to bring this project to birth.
Yeah.
And we talked about how hard it is to, first of all, get backing for a documentary, but also make money with a documentary.
Yeah.
And the rights.
And the rights. Yeah. And the music rights. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
And so, did you have the same issues on this one?
No. Yes and no. I mean, there's a point where, like, the Wrecking Crew, no one wanted to help out because at that time, no one ever thought music docs would ever make any money. There was an article in Variety in 2009. And when we had the film out and they were in the festivals and they said, Scorsese can't get his Stones doc, find a home for it. Demi couldn't find his Neil Young doc or Tom Petty, I can't remember which one. And then they said Denny Tedesco with his Wrecking Crew can't find a home. And I went, I'm on the page of losers. So I was thrilled.
No, you're not.
But it was just the reality of a business, you know.
But didn't streaming open things up
Netflix,
a little bit?
Yes, well, Netflix came in and then Magnolia picked it up. But yes, that helped tremendously. But again, there is a price for music, and that should be, because I went to school. These guys make a living, and they should be paid. Everybody should be paid through that. But it's really, you know, you have to prove it. And Louise is the first. She could totally relate to that.
Denny shows up at the first screening of my film at the Paley, and he's like, he comes up to me. And the film wasn't even finished, but the Paley wanted it. I'm like, all right, I don't have all the rights to all the clips and everything. Then he comes up to me and he's like, how are you paying for your rights? Like he was urgent about it. And yeah. I was like, I'm just paying because I don't have, lost that love and feeling. I have these Cowsill songs, but it's even like a clip from Mike Douglas. It's like whoever bought this stuff up wants to just pick up the phone and get paid. They don't see anything as promotional. None. It's a battle.
Yeah. Hey, Lee, don't you have to go to work? I'm just looking at the time.
Yeah, I'm going to have to sneak off here. I'm out here with Lyle Lovett. We're up in Grass Valley playing tonight.
Does Lyle want to come over and wave at us?
Lyle's in the film, too, and talked glowingly about you guys. We think so much of you, Lee. You're one of the nicest people we've ever met in this business, and thanks for talking with us.
Does anybody know you're in a closet, Lee? Because I see the ladder behind you.
Oh, you are.
Oh, goodness. That is a Zoom backdrop that will not ever meet its match. That is, I think he's at a gas station closet.
Yeah, I'm in just one of the storage rooms here in the venue that we're playing. But, man, it's such a pleasure. Fritz, man, I adore you. I've been such a fan of you forever.
Well,
you
I appreciate it. And we got such great feedback from your earlier appearance on this thing. And I hope you saw a huge bump in your YouTube viewership.
Oh no, it was out of control. I had to shave. I had to shave after that. I couldn't go to the market.
Thank you for being with us, my friend.
I do love the lunch boxes.
Oh, thanks. Well, when you're back in town, you can come over and we'll...
Yeah, any projects, we invite you guys to come and promote yourselves.
You can even play
shamelessly.
Live. This is a soundproof studio. We'll
anytime.
Your instruments.
I'd be happy to come there with you guys. Waddy, I love you. I miss you, my brother. Denny, I'll talk to you soon. And what a treat.
Bye, Lee.
See you later.
Thank you, Lee. Love you.
Bye, Lee.
Bye-bye.
Now we can talk about him. Oh, he's still
alive. Yeah. No, he's still
alive. Fuck him.
Damn it.
That was great. So we can wrap this one up so you can get going too, Waddy. And I'm really thrilled to hear that you found your cat because Denny opened with that and I got panicky.
It was insane.
Where was he?
We still don't know where she was.
Oh, okay.
Was she outside?
No. All of a sudden my wife said, here she is.
Wow.
We looked everywhere. There's not that many places in the house. I mean, I looked in every corner of this is my studio room. We looked under every couch, every chair, every cupboard.
Wow.
I still don't know where she was. Cats are kind of magical. So
they are magical creatures. Yes, it's very true.
You have a beautiful space there, as we saw in the movie, and all your horses. And God, it looks gorgeous there wherever you are. I'm surprised you ever want to leave that place.
I don't want to. And my wife is, I'm married to an incredible woman who's from Kentucky, and that's why
the
horses be part of our life, and they are wonderful.
Wonderful.
And it's a great space. Denny's been here, and
means a lot that you would spend some time with us, my friend.
Like Lee said, we're homebodies. We don't go out. I don't go hanging out anywhere and stuff. We stay home, and we don't get to be home that much. So
yeah, but if you can look out a window and see a horse, that's a nice home.
That's a good thing.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you for spending time with us, Waddy. We appreciate it so much.
It's just great to meet
you.
Good to see you,
man.
Bye bye. Daddy, talk to you later.
Love you.
Love you, buddy. Bye-bye, guys.
Bye. All right, Denny. So tell us where folks can see the film. And
well, it was released theatrically in December, and then it went to pay-per-view.
So does that mean it's eligible for Oscar nomination?
No, we were on the short list, but we didn't make it.
Okay.
It was last year.
Well, what do they
But do you know, realize when you're on a short list of 160, let's just say 160 movies,
yeah,
I had a better chance of winning the Oscar than the lottery.
Okay.
That was my only outcome of
you
that.
You
got
to be in it to win it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, no, we didn't make it. That's okay.
I think now the Oscar is if you haven't made this, if you haven't made your documentary on some Himalayan hilltop with goats and, you know.
That's my next one.
Because
is there a next one?
It's actually Wolfman Jack.
Oh
really?
That'll be huge.
I started that, and we were just trying to get the final financing. But I interviewed Richard Dreyfuss, Johnny Rivers.
Oh, yeah. From American Graffiti. Yeah,
I don't know enough about Wolfman Jack,
it's
it turns
wild.
Out. Yeah.
An era when they had these mystical characters
on
radio, and XCRB across the border.
You know it.
Dang.
And it's so, the greatest thing is with the family, I said to him, I would love to know who Wolfman Jack is. You know, I know him as Wolfman Jack. That's all we know him as. His character, a personality. And, you know, that's what he kept up going. And he was one of the first guys to syndicate. You know, he syndicated shows, recorded shows, sent it to Minneapolis, sent it to this, Armed Forces. And then the greatest joy of watching this or going through this research is they sent me all these VHSs. And I'm seeing Wolfman with a camera, you know, at Christmas time. Hey, Mom. What do you got there? What you get?
So did he always talk that way?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. It got worse over the years only for the reason I think he started that way and then it just got, you know.
He fried his voice.
But he did,
the originator of vocal fry.
But he was, when I see, he goes, Mom, what's, you know, let me see the gift. He goes, and she goes, that's a clock. And she goes, that's a wonderful clock. You know, I realize it's just like any of us at our home videos. And some of it is just.
So you had support of the family.
We actually, before I came here, I was on the phone with them today, or a Zoom call. We're just trying to get the final funds and then get on the road. And
you got to come and talk to us about that. I was a huge fan. That was an era when, you know, I remember when he went to WNBC in New York.
Right.
Imus was in the morning.
Yep.
And these guys were bigger than life. And I would tune them in, you know, on my little tiny AM radio in Philadelphia.
Right.
To them.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's all the stuff I'm learning about, too, which is amazing. Yeah.
He was huge.
Yeah. And the thing is, what's so great about it, he loved his family. He was this Todd, his son, said, you know, the guy was a hustler. Mm. I mean, he really was in terms of, you know, putting food on the table. You know, he figured out how to make money in this business.
Mm-hmm.
And Todd said, there was nothing in the house that wasn't a trade out. If it wasn't for the desk, if it wasn't for the drapes, if it wasn't for, you know, cars.
And he worked at XCRB, which down there they didn't have limits on the wattage. So it was
200,000. Yeah, 250,000 watts.
God.
And it was coming out of
Mexico. And he did his own advertising on there.
Yeah, and it started, and he jumped into, he kind of was hustling. He got the preachers. They were selling their, you know, their wacky
And then Imus
stuff.
Started to do the satires of that. And
oh, did he? Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, I mean, he was a great character. I can't wait to see your movie. But you have to come back and talk to us when you're ready to go with that.
Yeah, well.
All right, well.
But it's also, Media Family, it's just released last week or a couple of weeks ago on Blu-ray.
Okay.
And DVD. And the greatest thing about the Blu-ray is, I know if you still have one.
Hold it up, Denny.
Oh.
It's right there.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Thanks, Fritz.
Or Fritz, you hold.
So this, that has 3 hours of bonus material.
3 hours of bonus?
They gave me as much as I filled it. I got to 179.30 or something.
Wow.
And it was, so I had to go through all the, you know, I did the round table discussion, got that down to an hour, and did outtakes of the guys, each of the guys, and, you know, Phil Collins and Linda. And there's some wonderful stories you just can't put in there.
No, I understand. I've been on my YouTube channel. I've been releasing behind the scenes or uncut, you know, stuff from rough cuts and stuff from the Cow Sills.
Yeah.
Because you no longer have DVDs or you no longer have, like, you know, bonus material from films when they're just available through streaming.
Yeah, it's tough.
So my YouTube channel is just a great place to put up stuff that I think people will enjoy.
Yeah.
That I have anyway, and I probably should dive further into it because I have hundreds of hours of footage.
And the thing is, it takes time.
It's so time consuming.
People don't realize
what we have to do. And I'm cranking out a podcast every week, Denny.
I know. That's why it takes so much time, but someone enjoys it.
Oh, they do. They love it. And you get the comments on your YouTube channel, and then the conversation begins, and you find out how many other people had a family similar to this one, just without the music. They had a dad like Bud Cousel. They can relate to it. It's therapeutic to watch it.
That's one of the great family stories of all time, because you don't know where that thing's going to go.
No.
It's the shiny, squeaky clean, and then it goes dark, and it's so interesting. I love stars that give off a positive light. I mean, Lee is one, you're one. Waddy. I love it. And another one is Linda Ronstadt.
Oh, my God. That was one of the best interviews.
Oh, my God. And I'll tell you Linda Ronstadt's story. The second time I was on a Tonight Show, she was the headliner. And in the old Johnny Carson days, you would have the headliner for a couple of segments. Then the comedian would come on at like 10 after 12.
Yeah.
So Linda and I are both standing backstage, and I'm very nervous. I'm like the pacing comedian. I'm walking back talking to myself. And she comes up to me. She recognized me from television, and I had seen her at the Comedy Store because she was
dating. Right. You guys were all...
She went with Jim Carrey for a while, and she was always hanging out at the Comedy
Store. That's a cute couple.
Yeah, before the governor, she went with Jim Carrey. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm walking around, and I look really nervous. I look more nervous than I was. And she came up to me and said, "You're Fritz Coleman, right?" And she said, "Yeah, you're on after me." I said, "Yes. How you feeling?" I said, "I'm feeling great. I just look a little crazy." So she put her arms around me and just hugged me for like a minute. Didn't say anything, just held me in that hug for a minute. And I'm telling you, it was the most therapeutic 60 seconds of my life.
God.
I thought it was such a beautiful sort of a maternal thing to do. And I never forgot her for that. I said, "She's just a lovely person."
It's... Linda Ronstadt, hugs are very medicinal.
They really are.
I'd like to get one now. It's funny because when I went to interview her, it was right when her... film just came out. The documentary was a fabulous documentary.
So good.
And, you know, we were so lucky to get that. And then, thank God, we got it before COVID. And when I met her, it's like you see people you've seen your whole life, but they're not the same. You know, we know her from the albums.
Mm-hmm.
Now I see Linda Ronstadt in her 70s, and she, you know, with the disease she had, she shuffled like Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. And I saw my mother.
Mm.
And my mother had passed away a few years ago. It had Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. And I was like, "This is my mother." And I could see the disease, whatever disease she had, I felt it. And there was nothing better than her laughing.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And one of those stories on the Blu-ray I love to share was Bob Glob, the other bass player, his wife had a little pixie fairy outfit at a Halloween party, and she loved it, and they gave it to her. So she's wearing this on the road, and they're in Detroit on a bus, the whole band, and all of a sudden the guy makes a wrong turn, and now he's in Windsor, and he's in Canada. So he's like,
whoops.
So now they got to do a U-turn and come back across. Now they're all in a panic because all the drugs on the bus.
Uh-oh.
So all the players are throwing all their drugs out there, and she's laughing, telling the story, and they're throwing all the pot and the coke or whatever they had is out the windows, because they got to go through customs. And she says, "Let me talk to the customs agent, because my brother was a cop in Tucson." And the guy, the manager says, "No, you don't." He goes, because she's wearing the stupid outfit with the fairy. But she laughed. And every time she laughed, she's laughing at herself.
Yeah.
You know, that story of, you know, she would play the cards. And she said
she was the only sober one in the group.
And she beat the guys.
Yeah.
And it was just great. And then, you know. She must have been a lot of fun on the road.
I mean, she was the first bona fide female rock and roll star.
Yeah.
Where they realized that could be an industry, you know?
Yeah.
So she's ahead of Carol, ahead of Joni, ahead of those guys?
Well, I don't consider Carol and Joni a rock and roll star.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? In terms of sound wise, I mean, I would never have put that, but.
Yeah,
it's a
that's
different
a good
genre.
Point. Yeah, because she starts out with the ponies, right?
Yeah. So and the other thing is, Carol and Joni, they're writing their own stuff,
right?
And she's not a writer.
She's so a frontman. She's a frontman.
And totally getting some of the greatest writers.
She had the ability to pick great tunes.
Yeah,
in every genre. And then she was brave in whatever she wanted to do. Like, she'd go,
Do the big band thing, which my dad worked on. My dad was on that first album. Yeah, What's New.
Oh, cool.
He was on the What's New album.
I
and then
that.
Then she did goes
Broadway,
to Mexican.
She did and Pirates of Penzance, which is an operetta.
Spanish music.
She did the Spanish music.
I mean, and killed
it. Not afraid of anything.
No. I mean, that's what I think the hardest part is seeing these, when you see someone like her and she can't sing, you know, anymore. Mm. To take the, it seemed with my father at the end of his career, it was about not being able to play or taking the job because he couldn't play. You know, it was horrible for him. Not being having that, you know, that thing, that last thing you have, because you've lived that your whole life.
Right.
It's your identity.
It's how you speak.
It's how you speak. And these, like Waddy says in the film, I've never met anybody that retired from the music business that was happy. You know, in one of the outtakes that James Jackson and James Taylor talk about, Jackson says, you know, you keep going. You try to keep your chops up. You know, the guys that can keep their chops up can keep going. The fact that Lee and Russ are with Lyle this week.
Mm. You know, they're both up there.
They're both up there. And then you got Waddy's with Stevie Nicks. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're not playing with, you know, rookies.
No,
that's the greatest thing.
I was going to ask him that. So they're touring.
Oh,
God
yeah.
God bless them. That's great.
I mean, that's the hardest thing, you know, now is to, can we get the band together? We're actually in Savannah, Georgia. The band is playing, I think, on the 25th of April, and I'm showing the film on the 26th or vice versa.
Fun. Nice.
And it's a master class after the film with Russ Russ and Leland and Steve Postell.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Oh, that's wonderful.
I'm having the best time showing these films.
It's a great piece of work, as
Thank
was
you.
Wrecking Crew. And what comes through is your just love of the music. Your love of the music.
I love talking. It's like you guys. You love talking and meeting people. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not a musician. It's my only connection to being maybe close to being in a band. You know, I'll carry their instruments.
And being close to your dad.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a one. There could not have been a better salute to your father.
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
And it's funny because I think the next one is about family again. Mm-hmm. You know, the first one was about my father and his extended family, the Wrecking Crew.
Yeah.
And on this one, when immediate family, when they said to me, when they pitched the idea, I went, oh, I love that idea. Mm-hmm. I said, because their name's immediate family. I understood that. And the idea that these guys are different than the Wrecking Crew. They went on the road where my father would never leave town. You left town, you were way too busy to ever take a road gig. You're not going to take that.
Yeah.
And it was way too much money to take a chance on. And in the next one, Wolfman Jack, just the idea of him being a family guy. You know, he was married to the wolf woman, he called her.
Okay.
You know, her name was Lou. And it really meant a lot to him.
Is there any interview footage in there with him?
There is some of so many interviews.
Oh, good.
He's so able to pull some of those out.
He talked for a living, so I would imagine that.
I just wondered to keep his mystique alive, he didn't want to be interviewed by a lot of people.
No, but that's why the home movies are so good.
Yeah.
The home movies are hilarious. There's a point where he's puts the camera down and he's dressed up. And I think he might have been smoking or doing something because he's just dancing around, singing the song, whatever's in the background. And he looks up in the ceiling. He takes his little .22 caliber, goes bam, bam. And he's trying to kill a roach or something.
With a gun?
With a gun. But it was so small, but it was like, oh my God. But it was just so funny because there's a point where he and his daughter are driving on a North Carolina road and they're singing in the car. And I realize it looks like a setup, but it's not. It's just him holding the camera like a two shot and they're singing together.
He would have been a TikToker.
He would. Oh my God. You're right. He would have killed. He would have killed it. And all of a sudden they get pulled over by a cop.
Oh no.
And it's all on tape. I don't even think the family knows that's there.
Wow.
I'm looking at this stuff going, oh my God, this is beautiful.
Was this evidence presented in court at any point?
Well, the guy said, he goes, and the cop comes and he goes, hey, I'm Wolfman. He goes, hey, Wolfman, how are you doing?
Really?
Hey, just checking, you know, going a little too fast. Well, both slow down. Thank you, officer. And it's like, you know.
Oh my God.
It was just, you know.
Didn't try to Wolfman his way out of it.
He didn't need to do much.
No, you didn't. All you had to do was walk around as Wolfman Jack, and the world responded.
Yeah.
Did anybody try to commission you? The representation from some stars saw the Wrecking Crew and tried to commission you to do a piece of work about there?
I think that's where this came from.
Oh,
the Wolfman.
Cool.
You know, it's funny because I'm there. If anybody want, you know, everybody's got a great idea for a documentary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the problem is, as Louise will tell you, how are we going to finance it?
Mm-hmm.
The first for me, it was American Express, Wells Fargo, and B of A, and then I went bankrupt. You know,
well, the first
you
thing
don't
for
do
me
that.
is it, you know, and Denny knows how much work it is. So the first ingredient has to be passion.
Yeah.
I have to be so intrigued by this subject matter that I'm going to spend the next 3 to 4 years of my life immersed in it.
Yeah.
And so far, no one has approached me to where I felt the kind of
passion.
I'm not going
to do justice to it.
Yeah, I won't be able to do it
Someone
justice.
Someone offered me a job recently, and they said, "Do you know the group, blah, blah, blah?" I said, "I actually don't." And, you know,
and they always say it's a great story. And I'm like, I'm sure it is,
but it's
not my passion.
Learned more about it. And I thought, you know, guys, I won't do anything for it. I don't know it well enough.
Yeah.
I don't need to know everything. I don't.
Right.
I didn't know all the stuff that we just did, but I understood the concept of what we're doing and the memories. But I thought someone else should do that one on that other person.
Now, I watch PBS, which is still one of the great venues for documentaries.
Yeah.
And they have these, I guess they're consortiums of investors, like the documentary group they're called.
Oh, I don't
know. I mean, are there groups that can make these things viable for you?
If the people are starting to make money back, they'll continue making documentaries. The business is what it is. There's a lot of things, you know, you hear about these things being made. I'm just thrilled we found a distributor. I'm just thrilled that Magnolia came on because there's so many great docs I saw in the festivals that didn't get picked up and they have to find another pathway.
Right.
And you don't give up. You just find the other pathway. You put it out yourself in 4Wallet. That's what I kind of did for the Wrecking Crew all those years is 4Wallet and theater by theater by theater by theater and taken any money I earned and paid off all the publishing and all the labels because I had to make $500,000 after I made the film.
Yeah, no, what you did was truly heroic. Yeah.
But it's heroic or just desperate? Desperate. What I'm saying, I don't mean that in a – I had no choice.
No, you did. You did have a choice, Denny, because – finishing is the hardest part of life.
Yeah.
We all have ideas.
Yeah.
We all start things.
Yeah.
The people who finish, if you teach one thing to a child, it's, you know, honey, I need you to complete this so that you have that feeling of satisfaction
and
that you finished.
You're right. And that was, it's funny, I said this in an interview recently. I always felt like a quitter. I always felt like I never practice an instrument long enough to do a song. I could have been a one-man band. I played piano, sax, guitar, and even accordion. I never got there, you know, ever. And then it was like, you know, then writing. I wanted to write. Write scripts.
Mm-hmm.
A writer writes every day. A musician plays every day. An actor works at their craft every day. So I didn't have that. So when I got to that point in the Wrecking Crew, I was like, you know, 10 years into it, 12 years into it, when my wife said, we just made the most expensive home movie ever, and we got nothing for it. Meaning, like, we don't even have a cut. And then we started making a cut, and then we got into festivals, and then we did that, and that was amazing. But it was like, okay, now I put my family in kind of danger, in a sense. I'd be going bankrupt and stuff, and I realized, I got awards and all that stuff on the shelf. I got to keep going. If the film had failed in the festivals and did horrible reviews, you walk away, you brush it off. But I had to keep going to know I had to find that path to figure out how I could make money with this thing so I could pay off, you know, the debt or whatever.
And so now you have the Wrecking Crew, you have the
immediate
book.
Family.
You have
the book.
And
right,
what were some of, when you finished the Wrecking Crew, what were some of the other fruits of that labor?
I think that, you know, knowing like these musicians, having the, you know, with these guys, if I was nobody, meaning like I hadn't had, you know, the Wrecking Crew behind me, or these guys might not, no, we're not going to do a documentary with this guy.
Mm-hmm.
I had credibility, which is weird because I didn't realize how much credibility I had until musicians tell you, I love that film or it meant so much to us. And you don't have to be a professional. That had nothing to do with it.
Everybody.
Yeah. And that made me really proud. And I'm proud, you know.
You have to have a soul, because what you did was, in all the interviews that you did, you picked the right clips to show. And it was really an emotional journey. And in the end, it is a family.
It is.
That's what it is.
And even your crew's a family. Yeah. You know. And in the end, that's why I love doing, 63, and I love doing this. I finally found a career. I was a grip, and I did art department, and I did, Eating Raoul was my first film. You remember that one?
Oh, my goodness.
You know, I was in set decorator, and I was also the bodies in the bag. So,
wow.
The few people that out there will remember.
Props.
Yeah, it was props, yeah. But it was, I love this because I really do love meeting people, and they don't have to be famous. Mm-mm. I could.
Everybody has an interesting story.
That's it. Mm-hmm. I mean, and that's where each one of these guys could have had their own story.
Oh, yeah. But the way they complement each other and, the way that a huge part of their success is their beautiful personalities. Because you have to be a wonderful soul to be around to gel like that.
Yeah.
And to be able to accommodate yourself to every session, read the room, be what's necessary and be yourself.
You just said it. You said read the room. And what they were talking about, the professionalism is, and I watched my father, he was the king of studio players, not because he was the greatest guitar player. He was one of the greatest professionals in that business. He understood the business. He knew how to read that room. He knew when to lighten it up or get serious. And these guys, it is a job. And you get, my father said, listen, there's a point you play guitar for, you want to play. You love the instrument. You don't do it for a living. And then all of a sudden you get paid for it. Really make a living at it, like these guys and my dad did.
Yeah.
There's a level that they're a minority, but you still want to play guitar for fun.
Right.
But the professionalism, why they have longevity, is people want to be in the room with them. Obviously, their music speaks for itself. But if you don't want to be in the room with that person,
I always say that to kids who get started in broadcasting. I said, you'll be successful. 50% of your successes works well with others.
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
It's absolutely.
Absolutely.
And some of the fun stories in Wrecking Crew were when you recorded your dad teaching students.
Oh, those were the
AFI
seminars.
AFI or whatever they were.
Yeah, MI.
He was a very entertaining man. Yeah. He had very funny stories. Yeah. And I love that part of it, too.
No, and that was I got that. For me, it was... That's what he gave me.
Yes,
I love being able to share.
Oh, absolutely.
And now I'm taking this on the road, actually. I'm, like I said, I got that other screening, but we've done it where insurance guys will hire me to speak. And instead of a steak entertain, or instead of a steakhouse, I show the film and they have new contacts. They have 100 new contacts watching a film because our demographics are very much... insurance folks.
Music is everyone's second career.
Yeah.
Everyone's career is whatever they do, then show business, because at some point we're entertained, right? And also, you can find a lot of parallels between whatever you do and then how musicians work together.
Absolutely.
And create a team.
Absolutely.
And communicate. It's a conversation, but you're creating chords, and that's the harmony that makes life move. In a positive direction is like finding those people you harmonize with and creating a team.
Yeah.
So I think everyone can relate to what you've done.
Yeah.
So I'm going to read
I'm
going to read our closing credits because I think we need to wrap it up.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you so much for joining us. We would love to continue this conversation with you on Instagram and on Twitter, where we are at MediaPathPod, and on Facebook, where our show page is MediaPathPodcast, and our Facebook group is MediaPath with Fritz and Wheezy Podcast Community. You can find full video podcast episodes loaded with bonus visual content on our YouTube channel, which is called at MediaPathPodcast. We would love it if you would judge our appearance, please, and then subscribe. You can write to us at MediaPathPodcast@gmail.com, and we want to know what is on your media path. What have you been enjoying? Please share that with us. If you enjoyed this show, please give us a nice rating wherever you get your podcasts and share our social media posts so that your friends can learn about your excellent taste in podcasts. Our website is MediaPathPodcast.com. It is a great place to browse around and find interesting episodes you may have missed. We also have a fun and sassy newsletter loaded with bonus visual content, bonus photos, bonus quizzes, and more dish about our guests. prepare to find some dish about you in the newsletter, Denny.
Can't wait.
All the newsletters are right there for you to enjoy on our website, and you can sign up to get your newsletter sent directly into your inbox, just one per week. We do understand healthy boundaries. We want to thank our guests. Denny Tedesco was with us. Waddy Wachtel was with us. Leland Sklar was with us.
Thanks for bringing the boys. Oh, that was awesome.
And our team includes Dina Friedman, who is our producer, John Maddox, Bill Filipiak, Mason Brown, Garrett Arch, Jordan Reyes, and you. Our theme music is by me and John Maddox. I am Louise Palenker, here with Fritz Coleman and Denny Tedesco. Be well and wise, and we will see you along the media path.